Hello friends, this is Dr. Bhavika here. Currently, I'm doing ophthalmology from All India Institute of Medical Sciences, that is AIIMS in New Delhi. Friends, in this video, I'll be discussing some of the important concepts of the squint, as squint is one of the most difficult topics to understand at the UG level. So in this video, I'll be discussing some of the important concepts and some of the anatomy of the squint so that you can understand it better. Now coming upon to the extraocular muscles first. So there are six muscles in the eye. Four are recti and two are obliques. There are four recti, that is superior rectus, inferior rectus, medial rectus and the lateral rectus. And there are two obliques, that is superior oblique and the inferior oblique. Now coming upon to the origin of the muscles. First of all, the recti. The four recti are originating from the annulus of Zinn, which is attached at the apex of the orbit. And superior oblique, it is originating from the superior medial aspect of the optic foramen, which runs forward and it turns around the pulley, that is trochlea, and then getting inserted. And the inferior oblique, it has one peculiarity, that all the muscles of the eye except the inferior oblique, they are coming forward from the apex and then getting inserted. But inferior oblique, it is running posteriorly and then getting inserted. This can be understood more clearly from this diagram. In this diagram, there are superior rectus, lateral rectus, medial rectus and inferior rectus. They are all coming forward and they are all getting inserted here, here, here and this is here. And in the superior oblique, it is coming forward like this and it turning around the trochlea and then it is passing underneath the superior rectus. This is the superior rectus and it is passing underneath the superior rectus and then getting inserted here. And the inferior oblique, it is coming like this, coming backwards and then it is getting inserted here. And from now for the insertion, the four recti, they are inserted at a different distance from the limbus. Like this is the limbus, four recti are inserted on at a different distance from the limbus, like this distance. So this distance is different for every muscle. For this distance can be remembered by the mnemonic, that is SLIM. So superior rectus is inserted at 7.7 mm from the limbus and for medial rectus it is smallest, that is 5.5 mm. So medial rectus is nearest to the limbus as compared to all the recti. Now coming upon the superior oblique, as I already told you that it passes underneath the superior rectus and then get inserted on the upper and the outer aspect. And then inferior oblique, it passes forward to backward direction and then it get inserted on the lower and the outer part of the sclera. Now coming upon the nerve supply of the eye. There are three nerves which are dedicated towards the functioning of the eye, that is third nerve, fourth nerve and sixth nerve. So nerve supply can be understood by this mnemonic, that is SO4 and LR6. So superior oblique is supplied by the fourth nerve, lateral rectus is supplied by the sixth nerve and rest all the muscles of the eye, they are supplied by the third nerve. Friends, to understand the squint, it is very much important to understand the movements of the eye. If we know the movement of the eye, only then we will be able to understand the squint. So first of all, the ductions. Ductions, these are the uniocular movements. For example, if we close one eye and if we study the movement of that eye, then that is known as the uniocular movements. And for this, the name has been given ductions. For example, this is our right eye, this is a nasal aspect, this is a temporal aspect. And for adduction, if there is inward movement of the eye along the vertical axis, then this is known as adduction. And if there is outward movement of the eye along the vertical axis, then it is known as abduction. For supraduction, it is the upward movement along the horizontal axis like this. And for the infraduction, it is downward movement along the horizontal axis. Now for incycloduction or intorsion and for excycloduction or extorsion. For incycloduction, this is a rotatory movement along the anterior posterior axis in which superior part of the cornea like this stand up well o'clock position, if it is moving medially, this is known as intorsion. Similarly, if this point turns laterally, then this is known as extorsion. Now coming about to the versions. Friends, for virgins, you have to remember this is the binocular movements. And they are occurring in the same direction. For example, if both the eyes are moving to the right, then it's known as dextroversion. And if both the eyes are moving towards the left, then it is known as levoversion. Now, coming upon to the vergences. Vergences, these are binocular movements, but these are occurring in the opposite direction. That is, these are abnormal movements. For example, convergence. Like this, if these are both the eyes, and if both eyes are moving in this direction, that is medially, this is known as convergence. And if both eyes are moving laterally, then this is known as divergence. There is one difference between vergence and vergences. Vergences are in the same direction and vergences are in the opposite direction. Now, coming upon to the actions of the muscles. For actions of the muscles, you have to remember one thing, that golden rule, that superior are in tautors. Superior oblique and in superior rectus, they are both are in tautors. So, for the medial rectus, the primary action is adduction, and it is evident from its name that the action of medial rectus is adduction, that is medial movement, and the action of the lateral rectus is abduction, that is lateral movement. For the superior rectus, primary action is elevation. Inferior rectus, primary action is depression. And as I told you one thing, that superiors are in tautors. So the primary action of the superior oblique muscles is in torsion, and the primary action of the inferior oblique muscles is extorsion. Now again, for the secondary actions of the muscles, for a superior rectus, as I told you, superior are in tautors. So the secondary action of the superior rectus become in torsion, and for the inferior oblique, there is extorsion. Now here, friends, you have to remember one thing, that superior oblique and superior rectus, they have both opposite actions. For example, superior rectus and the superior oblique, its function is elevation and its function is depression. Although both are in tautors, but their action is different. There's one does the elevation and other does depression. Now, for the tertiary action, you can remember this diagram. For example, this is the right eye. This is the nasal aspect of the eye. This is the temporal aspect of the eye. And this is the right eye I'm talking about. And these are the four recti are getting inserted like this in the right eye. And superior oblique is present somewhere here. And the inferior oblique is present somewhere here. So as you can see, as compared to superior oblique and inferior oblique, superior rectus and the inferior rectus, these are present medially in comparison to the superior oblique and the inferior oblique. And the superior oblique and the inferior oblique, they are present little laterally as compared to the superior rectus and the inferior rectus. So the superior rectus and inferior rectus, they have a function in adduction. Basically, they are elevators in adduction. And for the superior oblique and the inferior oblique, they have a function that is abduction. Now for the synergist and the antagonist. Synergist and antagonist are the terms used for same eye. For if we are studying muscles of the one eye, so in that, for that we will use the term synergist and antagonist. For example, superior rectus and inferior oblique. As I already told you, superior rectus and the inferior oblique, they have same actions, that is elevation. So they are synergist. Antagonist, that is SR and IR. SR and IR, they both have an opposite function, so they will be antagonist. Now coming upon to the yoke muscles. The yoke muscles and the contralateral antagonist are the terms used for if we are studying both the eyes. And both the eyes, in this we are taking one muscles from each eye. So for the yoke muscles, they are contralateral synergist. Contralateral synergist, for example, right MR and left LR. For example, if one wants to look towards our left side, so in for that, left lateral rectus has to be functional and right medial rectus has to function. So they both are moving towards the left. And other example is right SR and left IU. for the elevation, right superior rectus will be functioning, and left IO will also be functioning. So they are both helping in the elevation. Now coming on to the contralateral antagonist. Contralateral antagonists are lateral rectus of both eyes. Right lateral rectus has its function in moving the eye towards the right side, and the left lateral rectus function has the function of moving the eye towards the left side. So they both have a different function. Now there are some laws of the ocular movements. First law is Herring's law of equal innervation. So in this, there is equal and simultaneous innervation to the yoke muscles. As yoke muscles has a similar action, so there is simultaneous innervation to the yoke muscles. Only then I will be able to function better. Now there is Sherrington's law. In this, this law states that there is increased flow of contracting muscle, increased flow to the contracting muscles, and decreased flow of innervation to the relaxing antagonist. For example, during dextroversion, like moving eyes towards the right, there is increased flow to the right LR and left MR, which is accompanied by decreased flow to the right MR and the left LR. For example, this I'll show you in a diagram like this. For example, during dextroversion, this is our right eye, this is the left eye. So for dextroversion, that is moving eyes towards the right side, there is increased flow to the right LR and left MR, increased flow and decreased flow to the right MR and the right LR muscle. So, and now the grades of the binocular vision. Friend, as you already know that humans have a binocular vision. So there are three components of the binocular vision. The first is simultaneous perception. That is, two similar objects if presented to both the eyes and if they are joined to form a complete picture. This can be done on a synaptophore. Synaptophore is an instrument which can be used to test the various abnormalities in the squint. So if these two slides are shown in the synaptophore, so the person sitting on a synaptophore will experience that if that person has a normal visual function, that person will feel that the loin is behind the cage. Similarly, for this fusion, if two incomplete similar images are shown and they both are perceived as a complete image. For example, if these two slides are shown in the synaptophore, person will perceive this image. That is, this complete image will be perceived by the patient if that patient has a normal visual function. But if the patient is having a squint, then he or she will not be able to perceive this normal movement. Now the third one is pteropsis. This is depth perception. Now coming upon to the one important aspect on the squint, that is diplopia. Diplopia, it is the perception of single object as two images. That is double vision. For example, if one object is present in the field, normal person will feel that there is only one object in the field. But if the person is having squint, then the person may perceive that there are two objects present in the field. So there are various types of diplopia, that is horizontal, vertical and torsional. That is diplopia in the vertical direction, diplopia in the horizontal direction, and diplopia in the torsion. And then there is crossed and uncrossed diplopia. Crossed, it is seen in the divergent squint, and uncrossed, it is seen in the convergent squint. Friends, there is one concept that why there is crossed diplopia in the convergent squint and crossed in the divergent squint, and why there is uncrossed in convergent squint. This can be understood from these following diagrams. For example, for this first view, you have to understand the normal functioning of the eye for this concept. For example, this is the normal eye, this is the right eye, and this is the left eye. F denotes the fovea. This is the fovea. As you all know, fovea is little temporal to the optic disc. So this is the optic disc present, and fovea is little temporal to the optic disc. So here, friends, F denotes fovea of both the eyes, and there are then in this pink and blue, there are corresponding points on both the retinas in both the eyes. For example, if this point, this pink point, and the corresponding point in the other eye is this pink point. and if there is this is a blue point, the corresponding point in the other eye is this blue point. So if there if and this for you have to remember one thing that if there is some object in the temporal field, so the nasal retina will perceive that temporal field, the temporal object, and if there is object in the nasal field, so the temporal part of the retina will see that nasal object. So for example, this is the object in the field, this is the normal object in the field, the image is formed at the fovea. Now if for example this if this object like this object is present on the right side of the eye, right side in the field, so as you all know, this is temporal for this eye and nasal for the left eye. As I already told you, for the temporal object, image will be falling on the nasal aspect, and for this also, for the left eye, this object is little nasal, so the object on the so the image will be falling on the temporal aspect of the eye, temporal aspect of the left eye. Now similarly for this object is present in the left side of the field, so left side of the field means it is temporal for the left eye and nasal for the right eye. So for the temporal object, for the temporal object in the left eye, image will be falling on the nasal retina, and for an object which is present on the nasal aspect, for the right eye, image will be falling on the temporal aspect. So in this, like if there is convergent squint means right, in this example we are studying for the right convergent squint. So for if there is a right convergent squint, visual axis will be rotated inwards like this. This is the right eye, visual axis will be rotated like this. So this blue, if eye will be rotated, then this blue point will come to lie at the position of the fovea like this, and all and the other two points are shifted temporally. Now for this, if the object is present in the center in the field, for the left eye, the image will fall on the fovea, but in the right eye, image will fall on the blue object, on the blue point. But as I already told you, if the image is falling on the blue point, though the person will perceive that the image is present on the right side. So the person will feel that image is present here. Although the image is present here, but person will perceive from his right eye that the image is present here in the field. So why uncrossed? These images are not crossing. This is a convergent squint. Images are not crossing each other, so this is uncrossed. Now similarly for the divergent squint in the right eye, so here if there is divergent squint, visual axis will be shifted like this. So in normal, so the in this divergent squint, this purple, this pink point will come to lie upon the fovea. This purple point will lie on the fovea, and this now if the image is present here in the field, it will fall normally on the fovea in the left eye, but in the right eye, it will fall on this pink point. But the pink point, if the image is falling on the pink point, the person will perceive that image is present towards the left side. So the person will feel that image is present here. So in this divergent squint, both the images are crossing each other here. They are crossing each other at this point. So that is why this is known as cross diplopia. Now friends, I think you must have understood why there is uncrossed in convergent squint and there is crossed in divergent squint. Now other type of diplopia can also be classified as uniocular एंड बाइनोकुलर. यूनिओकुलर मीन्स इफ देर इफ वी क्लोज द वन आई एंड इवन देन इफ वी कैन परसीव डबल इमेजेस देन इट इज नोन एज यूनिओकुलर डिप्लोपिया. एंड इफ द पर्सन कैन परसीव टू ऑब्जेक्ट्स इन इन द फील्ड विद बोथ आईज ओपन देन दैट इज नोन एज अ बाइनोकुलर डिप्लोपिया. देर आर फॉर द यूनिओकुलर डिप्लोपिया द problem or the pathology will be present only in the one eye, that is for example subluxation or the intumescent cataract. And for the binocular diplopia, the pathology is relative, so paralytic squint and the blowout fracture. So friends, these are all the basic concepts of the squint. So for the further I'll be discussing further topics in this point in my subsequent videos. So till then, thank you very much and keep studying, stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you very much.